This is the story of the four-leaf fish-packing plant in South Boston. But much of the history of this place is modern history in terms of Fallout 4. So to properly tell the story, we must first start with the side quest, Diamond City Blues. Now, Diamond City Blues is a really well-made quest. It's complicated, and there are quite a variety of outcomes, and a number of people involved in this quest, depending on the choices that you make. I'll be showing you one of those plot lines in this video. When you first enter the Colonial Tap House, you see a conversation between Paul Pembroke, his wife Darcy Pembroke, and bartender Henry Cook.
Damn it, Darcy, I just want you to come home.
I'll be home. Later.
I can't believe you'd do this to me, Cook.
Do what to you, Paul?
You smug bastard. You keep away from my wife, goddammit.
You'd better get out of here before you do something stupid.
You son of a bitch.
Don't hurt him, Henry.
Here we go.
I'll be at home, Darcy, taking care of our son.
You got plenty of drinks on tap.
What was that argument about?
Nothing much. You see, Darcy here likes to relax and enjoy life from time to time, and her husband Paul doesn't. He's not a bad guy, really. Just a little uptight. Too bad he can't learn to relax, huh, Darcy?
Shut up. I don't come here to talk about Paul.
Quite a pathetic situation indeed. If you talk to Paul Pembroke after he leaves the tap house, he asks you to help him confront Henry Cook.
Hey, you there. I have a question for you.
Go ahead. I'm listening.
You were in the tap house before when...
You got your ass kicked by your wife's lover.
Yeah. Pretty pathetic, right? Guy's sleeping with my wife, and I can't even do anything about it. I'm going to go back and talk to him, and I want you to come with me. You saw? He won't take me seriously otherwise. I don't want to have to really hurt him. I just want him to leave Darcy alone.
Let's go. You do the talking. I'll be the intimidating presence.
All right. Come on.
Paul! Where are you going?
Nowhere you need to worry about.
Whatever.
I'll see you at home.
We need to talk.
Jesus, Paul. What now?
It's time for you to shut up and listen, Cook.
What the hell is this? And what are you doing here? Don't tell me he's hired you to help lean on me.
What difference does it make?
I just like to know who to shoot at when the guns come out. Well, I'm listening, Paul. What do you have to say this time?
Just this. You leave Darcy alone, starting now, or else.
Now that is a very bad idea. You don't want to pull a gun on me unless you intend to use it.
But you think I won't use it? Huh? Do I just need to kill you? Is that what you're saying?
Why don't you see if Cook is gonna listen?
Oh, he never listened.
This one's mine.
Now, if you fail to calm down the situation, you're forced to kill Henry Cook, in which case just loot a note on his body, which will allow you to proceed with the quest. Otherwise, if you calm things down, Henry Cook, as a way of making amends for sleeping with Paul's wife, offers to allow you both in on a cut of a chem deal that's about to go bad.
Look, I'll stay away from Darcy from now on. It's over. You have my word on that.
Your word? What's your fucking word worth, huh?
I'll make it up to you. I know a way to get a lot of money right now. I owe you for what I've done.
How are you gonna make us all rich, Cook?
Gather around and I'll tell you. Here's the deal. I have some other, businesses on the side. One of them is helping Nelson Latimer spend his dad's money to make himself feel like a gangster.
Holy shit, Cook, does Malcolm know about this?
What do you think? No, of course not. Anyway, that's between him and Nelson. Me and Nelson are supposed to be meeting some gentleman from Good Neighbor to exchange Nelson's cash for their chems. My plan is simple. We take the money and the chems.
Why do you want to screw these guys over all of a sudden?
Oh, it isn't all of a sudden. Nelson's been complaining about my cut for a while now. He may be thinking about trying to strike out on his own. I've been waiting for the right opportunity to present itself, and here it is.
Why smuggle chems into Diamond City? Chems aren't illegal here.
Sure, but Mayor McDonough takes a big cut of all the chems brought into town. Not everybody thinks that's good business. That's where me and Nelson come in. He fronts the cash, I make the arrangements. Cheap chems for Diamond City. Everybody wins.
I'm in. Let's do this.
What do you say, Paul? Are we good?
Good? Hardly. But I don't mind you helping me get rich.
Nelson Latimer is the son of Malcolm Latimer, a wealthy, snobby guy who hangs out in the upper stands.
You belong down in the lower section of the city. It's more suitable for those lacking in ambition.
Nelson Latimer has gotten it into his head that he wants to be a big-time gangster, so he has been involved in chem deals with Marowski. Marowski is a chem dealer who works out of the Hotel Rexford in Good Neighbor. Nelson and Henry Cook work with Marowski to smuggle chems into Diamond City. Now, chems are not illegal in Diamond City, but the reason they need to smuggle them in is because the mayor of Diamond City, Mayor McDonough, takes a very large cut of all chem sales in Diamond City. All three people, Nelson, Henry, and Marowski, want to avoid this chem tax, and so they do a back alley arrangement to smuggle chems into Diamond City. Now, Henry Cook feels that Nelson Latimer is trying to find a way to get Henry Cook out of the deal. If he can, then Nelson will walk away with a larger cut of the profits. Before Nelson can do something so rash, Henry Cook wants to betray him first. He leads you and Paul to the location of the chem deal.
Here we are. The meet is just ahead. There's always four of Marowski's goons. Trish, who's in charge, and then three other guys to unload the boat and wave their guns around. I'll wait for the shooting to start, then join in from here. Remember, we can't afford to let anybody get away.
Nelson is talking with Trish, a female ghoul, who is part of Marowski's gang.
You better get the fuck out of here if you know what's good for you.
Cook sent me. He has a message for you.
Cook told you about this? Where the hell is Cook anyway?
What is this, Nelson?
This is a holdup. Drop your guns.
Are you serious? Kill this asshole!
No matter what speech options you choose here, Nelson Latimer and the Triggermen fire upon you.
Are you gonna hand over the money in chems, or do I have to kill you?
Are you serious? Kill this asshole!
It'd be simpler if you just hand over the money in chems.
Are you serious? Kill this asshole!
Cook couldn't make it, so he sent me instead.
The fuck he did? Trish, kill this asshole!
Once dead, Trish is left alive but wounded, and she begs for her life.
You don't have to kill me. I won't talk. I swear.
Give me a reason not to kill you.
I don't need a better reason than to shut her up.
I'll tell Marowski it was Gunners, okay? You can trust me. And I'll give up Marowski's chem lab. This here? This is nothing compared to what he's got stashed there.
What's at this chem lab?
More chems than you can imagine. Marowski's entire stash. But you'll never find it without my help.
Why do I need your help to find this lab?
Because first, you don't know where it is. Second, even if you did know where it was, it's heavily protected. Third, even if you can get past the security, you won't be able to get into the lab without my password. But I'll tell you everything you need to know if you promise to let me go.
You've got a deal.
Okay, I guess I have to trust you. The lab is in the old Forley fish packing plant, on the waterfront in South Boston.
Let's hear about all the security.
The place is overrun with feral ghouls, which don't even look twice at my crew, because they're all ghouls like me. My idea, by the way.
Why wouldn't the feral ghouls bother you and your crew?
What, you don't know? Ferals don't bother us normal ghouls. I don't know why. Maybe we taste bad or something. But they're just for cover anyway.
Pretty slick. But I assume that's not the end of it.
You assume right. The real security is a system of tripwires that have to be triggered in exactly the right order to open the door to the lab. You never even know the lab was there when the door is closed.
You seem awfully proud of this lab.
Yeah, I am. Marowski's operation wouldn't be nothing without me. There's a terminal that will bypass the tripwires and open the door to the lab. And I have the password. So, I have your promise, right? If I give you the password, you let me walk?
And you promise to not tell Marowski that I had anything to do with this?
Yeah, of course. I already told you. After I leave here, I've never heard of you in my life. The password is Applejack. There, Now you've got everything, and I'm completely screwed forever. I hope you can live with it.
And now if you kill Trish, you find Trish's note on her corpse, which shows you how to get into Morawski's chem lab, but you do have the option to allow her to go peacefully as long as she tells you the location. The problem is that if you choose this option, Henry Cook opens fire and kills Trish. Now you can try to kill Henry Cook before he kills Trish, but if you do, Paul Pembroke opens fire upon you, forcing you to kill him too. If you allow Henry to kill Trish, Henry allows you and Paul to split the spoils. He says that he's moving on, and he considers his debt to Paul paid.
The money should still be on Nelson's body. And then there's these chems, which you'll need to sell somehow. But that's your problem now. I'm leaving town, for good. Should make things easier for Paul to have me gone. Plus, there's no plausible way I could explain to Morawski how I wasn't involved in this unless I die here along with everyone else.
Just like that? You're leaving town and never coming back?
Yeah. You won't be able to blame me for all your problems anymore.
You're leaving already? But we were having so much fun together.
I think I'm getting too old for your kind of fun.
So it's just the two of us. 50-50 seems fair to me.
Paul then offers to split the spoils with you 50-50. However, if you choose this option, you get the caps on Nelson's body and only a few of the chems. The chems are much more valuable than the caps. You can try and negotiate for a 70-30 split, in which case you get all the chems.
70-30 seems more like it.
Should have asked for it all, but this'll do.
Yeah, whatever. Screw me over one more time. Guess I should be used to it by now. You can deal with selling the chems then. Give me half of Nelson's money, and I guess that's the best I can expect.
Works for me. Good luck.
Good luck? You're a real piece of work. I'm done here.
If you choose this option, you walk away with the largest single haul of chems you can ever find in the game. Now, Trish did say that Morawski's chem lab has way more chems than she has here, but we'll find out whether or not that's true in a moment. This is an incredibly valuable haul at early levels because you can use a chemistry station to combine these chems into more potent forms, which is great for earning experience. Now, what's the moral option here? Well, none of them really are very moral options. Unlike many drugs in our world, chems are not illegal in the Fallout world. There's nothing inherently wrong with Morawski running a chem dealership. He's just running his own business. There's nothing inherently wrong with Nelson and Henry trying to get chems into Diamond City. All they're really trying to do is avoid an unnecessarily heavy tax from Mayor McDonough. So basically, getting involved in this quest at all is kind of morally gray, if not bad. It's wrong to kill Trish, who's just doing her job. It's wrong to kill Henry, whose greatest crime is having an affair with Darcy. And it's wrong to kill Paul, who's just trying to make a better life for himself. So, in my mind, there's no good choice. Now, if you allow Trish to escape, Trish tells Morawski that you stole the chems. Morawski from Good Neighbor then puts a hit out on you or forces you to pay 2,000 caps. If you killed Nelson Latimer, Nelson's father puts a hit out on you unless you pay him 2,000 caps.
Did you kill my son Nelson?
I'm not sure. I don't always get the names of everyone I kill.
My son's death is a joke to you? You son of a bitch. We'll see who has the last laugh.
But if you have high charisma, you can convince Morawski that Latimer stole the chems, or you can convince Latimer that Morawski killed his son. In which case, one party will hire you to assassinate the other party, turning you into an assassin, which is definitely not a moral option. So as I said at the beginning, this is a complicated questline with a lot of moving parts. It's one of the most well-written quests in the game. But Trish tells us that Morawski's chem lab is at the Four Leaf Fish Packing Plant. When you get there, you find a series of tripwires set up. Now, Trish gave you a note that shows you the correct order that you need to trip these tripwires to gain access to the lab. These tripwires don't trigger any defense mechanism. There are no sirens, alerts, flamethrowers, bombs. There's nothing that harms you if you mess up when triggering them. The reason it's important is because the only other way into the chem lab is if you have rank 3 of hacker, which allows you to hack into the terminal. At younger levels, you may not have this, in which case the only way in is to trigger these tripwires in the correct order. So according to the note, we have to trigger the first one first, the third one second, the one by the door third, the second one fourth, and the fifth one fifth. As you trip the tripwires, the tripwire will make a beeping noise and disappear if you triggered the right one correctly. Now, to get to the second one without a jetpack, you need to run around to the side of the plant and hop on top of a garbage dumpster. This allows you to leap over the wall and trigger the second tripwire. Then, to go trigger the third tripwire, you gotta go back the way you came, shimmy around the fence by hopping up on the dock, running around the truck to the main door of the fish packing plant. Then you can trip the third one. Then go back around the truck towards the catwalk that leads to the roof where you can trigger the fourth one. The roof is swarming with feral ghouls. To get to the chem lab, you have to clear the entire roof because the catwalk down to the chem lab is on the opposite side of the roof. Before you go down, don't forget to unlock the safe at the very top of the catwalk by the exhaust pipe. Once done, you find a terminal on a blank wall and the final tripwire. You can either open the secret door by hacking the terminal, or, once you've correctly triggered all the other tripwires, trip this final one. This opens the secret door to Murawski's chem lab. Inside, we find a bunch of ghouls dressed in hazmat suits. Which doesn't make a lot of sense to me. I mean, they're already ghouls. I suppose the chemicals that they're working with to create these chems are hazardous even to a ghoul's health. At any rate, they immediately become hostile and you are forced to kill them. You are then free to loot Murawski's secret chem lab. However, we immediately learn that Trish was lying. The haul in the crates out by the docks is way, way, way more than the number of chems you can find in the lab. I suppose we can assume that most of the chems they had already manufactured had already gone out for delivery, and they had yet to manufacture more chems. You still walk away with a tidy sum of chems, at least compared to most other dungeons, but certainly not as much as you found during the chem deal. In the back of the chem lab, you find a door that leads to the interior of the fish packing plant, but we'll go back outside and go through the main entrance to explore the fish packing plant. Inside, we see a bunch of catwalks above us and a couple of different levels beneath us. This, like the rooftop, is swarming with all sorts of feral ghouls, so you'll have a lot of fun dispatching these fellows. The place is also a great source of aluminum, because you can find a whole bunch of trays in there and aluminum cans. Sadly, the terminals in this place do not tell us the story of the workers here before the war. The only story we get is from the skeletons that dot the place. We find two skeletons lying, each of them clutching a pack of cigarettes and lighters. One of them actually has a cigarette still in its mouth. How a cigarette could have stayed in the mouth of a skull as its face decomposed, I'll never know. But hey, smoking is bad for you, kids. If you go down towards the basement, there's a big concrete structure with pipes coming out of it. If you hop up on top, you find a skeleton lying on a dirty mattress next to a minigun. This minigun has some decent mods on it, which is great for those of you at a low level who have not quite specced into gun nuts yet. In the basement level bathrooms, we find a skeleton face down with his head kissing a skull lying in a urinal. What the heck, Bethesda? Why would this be here? There's no way this could happen naturally. So either raiders did this or the ghouls before they became ghouls. I don't know how we can explain this with lore. Just outside the bathroom in the locker room, we find Tales of a Junktown Jerky Vendor, Capitalism and You, which permanently gives you better prices when purchasing from a vendor. Back on the main floor, we find a room where the conveyor belt ends. There's a skeleton lying beneath some crates. It looks like his head was crushed by a giant crate. In this room, you can also activate a construction Protectron. You can use the Protectron override software that you get from Watts Electronics to hack the Protectron and turn it into a temporary follower. In the same room where we find the Protectron, we find a fusion core just lying on one of the shelves. You can actually find three fusion cores at this plant, one on the roof, and the third is inside a fusion reactor on the second floor next to a large safe. Up the stairs, we find even more skeletons, one holding a clipboard, one holding a coffee cup, and then a random rib cage shoved under the shells. After the bombs dropped, the workers must have been trapped inside the fish packing plant, but it looks like they died rather quickly from radiation exposure. Many of them are still holding the work-related items that they had during life, and some seem to have even resigned themselves to their fate. Those are the ones smoking cigarettes, I bet. If you head up the catwalk to the very top, we find a little room with the legendary ghoul inside, and yet another skeleton splayed out with its mouth agape. If you look up, you find a broken catwalk that leads to a door. This is only accessible if you have a jetpack. This is the door that leads to Murawski's chem lab. You can only open it from within the chem lab itself. This was Bethesda's way to make sure that you can really only get to the chem lab if you go through the Diamond City Blues questline, or you happen to be later in the game and you have high levels of the hacker perk and you stumble upon it then. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the full story of the four-leaf fish packing plant in Fallout 4. There is very little history we can piece together about what went on here before the war, but after the war, it became home to dozens of feral ghouls, and it was the location of Murawski's infamous chem lab, which he used to produce chems for Diamond City and Good Neighbor. This place is smack dab in the middle of South Boston, surrounded by a bunch of other really interesting factories and buildings. I plan to go through each and every one of them meticulously. Thanks for watching, everybody. I hope you liked this video. If you have any questions or other feedback about the four-leaf fish packing plant, be sure to join the Oxhorn community on our Discord server, where you can chat with other like-minded individuals about Fallout. If you like this video and you want to support me in a more personal way, consider becoming one of my patrons on Patreon. Patreon subscribers gain access to a private channel on my Discord server, as well as a bunch of other cool Oxhorn perks. But more than anything, ladies and gentlemen, I'm just so glad you're here watching this video today. Thanks for watching from the bottom of my heart, and I'll see you bright and early tomorrow morning with a brand new video.